or something.
He had said, if that doesn't sell, I'll buy it. And then he came in 2 minutes later, I want the cranberry bread. There goes bread.
Well, that's a piece of shit.
Yep.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So good to hear all this talking. I don't want to really interrupt it.
I don't think you can stop it.
No.
Well, don't forget.
Big voice.
I guess we online, folks. We're sorry. No. Well, the cookie walk, you're in luck you came to church today. There's still cookies, so I think they're still going on right after service. Yes?
Sure.
No? Yes? Maybe? Yes. I don't know. So you can check out and see if you can get some cookies. And also, this beautiful poinsettia up here is from Mary Picarni in loving memory of her brother Joe, who went to heaven 40 years ago. And that's just a good reminder to us to be mindful of folks who this is a hard season, especially as we come on up on the shortest really week of the year as far as sunlight is. And this week's supposed to be really gray too. So I have two little solar spotlights that have worked great for me for years, but this year they're only running when there's sunshine during the day, so it's tough time for them. Don't forget the Heifer Project's got heifers, got animals for sale. If that's a great gift you like to give, please stop by the table in the foyer. And here's the big news I need today. We always need something, right? So we have had a great week here. This last week we had the beautiful time at the gala on Tuesday night. Such gorgeous tables. We had a kids club rehearsal, and the kids club event is this Wednesday at 3:30. This is your opportunity to see some kids doing the Christmas story. It's wonderful. And have more treats. And then Thursday this week, we got ready. We had the packages coming in for Christmas for kids. We got the food coming in for love boxes. And we had the Mountain Mission people come. Yeah, it was a busy Thursday. Then Friday, they packed the boxes for love boxes. And then Saturday, we sent everything out. And today, we're having cookies. All that happens in the fellowship hall. Well, today, after the cookie walk, I need 19 tables and chairs set up in the fellowship hall going north and south. So if you could just stay, some of you guys, if all of you could stay, we're going to get a few out of a classroom and put the chairs around all the tables. That will be a huge help to finish out our grand week of activities. Okay? Yes. Thank you. All right, so that is the big announcement, and I'll remind you before we leave to please stay and just, there's several tables up, so we'll just get enough for 19 tables running north and south. All right, I can see you're thrilled with that information. All right, that's all the announcements I have. Happy birthday. We've got so many great birthdays. Marissa's is today. Mackenzie's, happy birthday to all those folks. And the week just keeps going. Jerry and others, Randy, my husband, plenty of people, John, having birthdays this week. So happy birthday, all you poor December Christmas birthdays. And happy anniversary to the Fransons and Curtises and to the Trainers. So happy anniversary to all those folks. And if you're celebrating, we celebrate with you. All right, God is good, friends.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Let's stand together and join in singing our opening praise. Invite the Irvin family up.
Joy to the world, our Savior reigns. Because of God's great faithfulness and love for us, we are people filled with joy. The time is coming when we will sing and dance with everlasting joy. The prophet Isaiah tells us in chapter 35, verse 10, the redeemed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. We live into that time, this Advent season, as we fill our hearts with joy. We light our first candle as a symbol of Christ, our hope. We light our second candle as a symbol of Christ, our love. We light our third candle for Christ, our joy. Let us pray. God of the Advent, forgive us when we forget that you have done what you have done for us through the birth of Jesus and allow the cares of the world to steal our joy. Prepare our hearts this day to recognize Emmanuel, for you are with us. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, may we feel the joy, the love, the hope that your presence provides throughout or through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
And we'll invite the youth and children up. It's their time this morning. Miss Stacy's coming down, so come on down, everybody.
Good morning.
Got a nice group of boys again.
A big crew today.
Hi. Welcome.
No girls. One to come.
All right. So I need your help. I always need your help. Do we know what this is? A magnifying glass. So very smart. We can never pull anything over on them. You are right. What does a magnifying glass do? It helps us to see. How does it help us see? You're right. Yes, it does. Right. What else were you going to say? Look at things that are tiny, and this makes it look smaller or bigger. When we look at it through here, does that make it look smaller or bigger?
Bigger.
All right, Coop, what were you going to say?
Helps
us to see smaller words. Now, can we use it for anything else besides helping us see things?
Big letters.
Clues. Oh, we could use it for clues. That's true. Well, Dave Taylor was telling me earlier at first service that when his boys were younger, he used a magnifying glass and some leaves to start a little fire. So we're not going to do that part today. But so it does help us see things. And in our Bible story today, we're going to talk about Mary, the mother of Jesus, and she said her soul magnifies God. Do you think Mary had one of these things? Nope, that's not quite what she means, but she is saying it helped her to see things that God was doing. She could see parts of God very clearly. So she could see that God has great mercy. That means he's really kind and looks out for everyone when they're suffering. And God gives us strength. And Mary needed lots of strength as she was carrying baby Jesus. And everything was new to her. And she could see that God gave us encouragement. That means when we're kind of feeling down or sad, that we feel okay in our hearts then. And Mary could see and magnify that God gives us good things, lots of good things. And guess what? By saying all those things, Mary was magnifying God to the rest of us. She was helping all of us to be able to see God better. And she's not the only one who magnifies God. When Jesus was born and then he grew up and he did all the things, miracles and teaching and preaching, that was helping us to see God better and more clearly too. And his mother Mary and Jesus' friends, the disciples, and his cousin John the Baptist, they all worked to make things easier for us to see God clearly. The better that we can see God, then we can be magnifiers and share God's glory with others. And our hearts will be filled with joy. Right? Coop and Seth's family talked about joy, so that's our special word for today. So let's say our prayer, okay? Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For Mary and Jesus.
For Mary and Jesus.
And the many others.
And many others.
Who magnify. Your love.
Your love.
Mercy and grace.
Mercy and grace.
That helps us.
That helps us.
To magnify.
To magnify.
Your love.
Your love.
Mercy.
Mercy.
And grace with others.
And grace with others.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And all God's people said,
Amen.
Thanks, boys. You did an awesome
job.
Thank you,
everybody. One way we magnify God and give glory to Him is through how we give. That's a thing we can determine about our faith. How giving are we? And we saw how giving we were this week through all the different activities we did with love packages and Christmas for kids and love boxes. So those are wonderful ways we've given love out into the community, but a wonderful way that we magnify our great God and show our trust in Him is by how we give to His work of His kingdom through the local church. And so as you prepare to give your offerings today, do so with joy in your heart and thanksgiving for all the wonderful things God has done for you and all the good things your gifts do for the world. So we'll invite our ushers to come forward as we join in singing our next song, Silent Night, Holy Night. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, how thankful we are that you have come and are still coming into our world in new ways. We ask that our tithes and offerings, the gifts that have been presented, will be used to invite people to know you and to know your great love for us in Jesus. Oh Lord, accept these gifts and those who have given in all the different ways that we do, online, in person, in the mail. Accept them and multiply them and empower our church to continue to be that beacon of hope, of love, and especially of joy out into this hurt and broken world. We thank you for your great love that we know best because we know Jesus, in whose name we pray. And all God's people say, amen. Well, our scripture lesson today is just the beginning of the story of Mary and Elizabeth. And to hear the Magnificat, the story where she magnifies God through all that she does, you'll need to read the verses after this. And I hope you do in Luke's Gospel, chapter 1. I hope you read the rest of the story and hear that beautiful Magnificat, as it's called in church language, about Mary magnifying God and all the great things that he has done. But we're going to look at this story at the beginning, right after Mary has been found to be pregnant, and she goes to be encouraged, and she goes to her cousin Elizabeth. So let's share together Luke chapter 1, verses 39 through 44, and as is our tradition, let's read our scripture out loud together. A few days later, Mary hurried to the hill country of Judea, to the town where Zechariah lived. She entered the house and greeted Elizabeth. At the sound of Mary's greeting, Elizabeth's child leaped within her, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Elizabeth gave a glad cry and exclaimed to Mary, "God has blessed you above all women, and your child is blessed. Why am I so honored that the mother of my Lord should visit me? When I heard your greeting, the baby in my womb jumped for joy." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to our great God. Amen. Well, we're in our third week of Advent as we journey towards Christmas. And so last week, our invitation was to be loving. And so if you got that invitation, or even if you didn't, how loving were you? How good were you at loving other people? That we know that it's hard. It's hard to love people. And we might look at a young girl like Mary and out, and we might think, well, Mary would be easy to love. It's easy to love a pretty young girl that is in that growing womanhood of her life. Well, that's easy to love. But I'd ask you then, really, how loving are you to single mothers? How loving are you to teenage pregnancies? How loving are you to, if you're in paid good money to go out to dinner, and all of a sudden there's a bunch of distraction from rowdy kids that aren't keeping, you know, that are out, or unhappy kids, right? How loving are you then? Sorry, me and the thing got had a little fight. How loving are you towards them? And we wonder, how loving was Mary's family towards her? We don't know anything about Mary's family. They're not mentioned in the regular scripture at all. And so we can just assume that part of Mary's, part of the response people had when Mary said, "I'm pregnant." And that then they said, you know, "Oh, well, she's engaged to be married. Oh, he's not the father." Great. And then what would be your response when she tells you, "No, the Holy Spirit's the Father"? Now you've really got some issues, right? You'd be wondering, what is going on? And so how loving would we be to that? And that's the challenge for us, that joy is not a word that we would use in that kind of situation, right? Would Mary be joy-filled? Would this be the joy situation? Wow, this looks like the ideal picture of what you want to bring a child into, right? No. Now, we might use words like stressed, worried, anxious, but we might not use the word joy, and yet that's what we lift up this Sunday, that joy is the word we use in all sorts of situations, that we have and can be people of joy no matter what our world is, what has our lives going on. And we, as God's people, then can take joy out into our world. So I would challenge you, if you have ever had times that didn't make you feel joy-filled, and if you're like Mary, and we can imagine Mary not only had family that shamed her, But she might have even had, and we know that there was some shame going on because Joseph, when he heard about the pregnancy, had decided that he was going to dismiss Mary quietly because not only did Mary have her own family that had issues maybe with this pregnancy, but she also had issues in her close-knit Jewish community, and that was what Joseph was a part of. But it went bigger than that. Mary might have told people that she was carrying God's son, the Messiah. Now that became a political issue. And we know Herod did not respond very well to hearing that. So not only did Mary have the social response of her community, but she had a political issue to deal with too, that her own safety and the life of her child and her own life might be at jeopardy, because we know what Herod did when he learned that Jesus had been born. And we don't read that in church because it's so ugly, but he sent out a decree to kill all the children 2 years and under when the wise men showed up. And so there is political consequences, social, religious consequences to Mary and this unborn child. And so how would Mary take this joy that she had out into the world, giving these ceremonies, giving all that was going on? And if you've ever had family shame, or if you've ever experienced that in your own life, or you know someone close to you who has, then you should remind them. God knows that experience. Jesus' family had that experience. And so God is sensitive and with you in these hard times. And be assured that God knows about these kind of things. And God has walked with them and is walking with you. And Mary knows, so you can't carry this kind of joy alone. You can't carry these kind of gifts that are very difficult. You don't carry them alone. You need someone to carry them with you. And we get that passage. I use this a lot. I've used it at weddings, where in Ecclesiastes it says, two are better than one. And it ends with, a cord of three strands cannot quickly be broken. And in a wedding, of course, sometimes people use a braid on a cross or something to illustrate that is the bride, the groom, and the Lord is in there. And Mary knew that too. Now, she didn't have a groom and yet in her life, but she knew two are better than one. And so that's a good reminder for us that we should pair up. And at least with another person. And it doesn't matter that kind of person who it is. Mary paired up with an older woman. That wouldn't be someone that you would expect her to pair up with. She went to her cousin Elizabeth, who was quite older and had a miraculous pregnancy too. And so she paired up. So who I would invite you this week, as you seek to live as a person of joy, who do you pair up with? I heard a great story about a couple people that paired up that I wouldn't have paired them up to deliver. I think they were delivering love boxes, but they had a great time doing it together. So who can you pair up with to help your joy, but also to share joy out into the world? Who can you pair up with? And as I said, Mary found her cord that was strong with her cousin Elizabeth. Now remember Elizabeth's story is an odd one, and actually begins with her husband Zechariah, who was the high chief priest, one of the priests that was chosen to go into the Holy of Holies and to take care of the inner part of the temple, the most holy part of the temple. So he was very respected. And while he was in there, he had the angel visit Gabriel. And Gabriel told him he was quite old and his wife Elizabeth was quite old. And he was told that they would now have a child. And Zechariah thought that was ridiculous. Yes, he did. You can read about it in Luke. And so that I would encourage you, if you have an angelic encounter, the one thing you do not say to an angel is, you're stupid. Are you crazy? Don't say that. You're usually afraid, but at least don't say that. Because Zechariah was like, are you crazy? That can't happen. And the Gabriel said, I am Gabriel from the Lord Most God High, and you are not going to talk back to me. In fact, you're not going to talk again until the baby's born. Talk about zip your lip, Zechariah, zip your lip. So Zechariah, they knew he'd had an angelic encounter. He comes out and he's totally shaken, but until the baby's born, he doesn't shake again. He doesn't have any words to say again, but he and Elizabeth do create a baby, and it's John the Baptist. So Mary has heard, everyone, of course, had heard about this miraculous event. And so when Mary had her own angelic encounter, she goes to seek support from another. Remember, two are better than one. So she goes to her cousin Elizabeth. And Adam Hamilton has this to say about this whole thing. He said, he in his book, A Journey, Adam Hamilton's a famous pastor, United Methodist pastor, and he said that He didn't believe that Mary had really lived into her angelic blessing until Elizabeth told her that, yes, she was blessed. Yes, her child was blessed. And yes, that this was part of God's plan, and it was awesome. And when, after Elizabeth says that to her, then Mary does the Magnificat, that she claimed her own blessedness then. But regardless whether she had claimed it before or not, she knew she couldn't carry this joy into the world alone. And so she went to Elizabeth, and we know a young girl helping an older woman, trust me, I take help any time of the day, and I'm not quite that old yet, but still, it's a wonderful thing to mix adults and kids together, and so they were a blessing to each other. So again, if you are on a journey and it's hard, which we all are, don't do it alone. It doesn't mean you have to have a romantic partner to do it with you. This is not Hallmark. Instead, you need to find a partner that fits you. And it might come in unexpected ways, shapes, and sizes. But find a person of faith to encourage you, that you can encourage to live out the joy that God has for us to share and live into in our own lives. So we think we have plenty of time until Christmas, but today is December 11th. We're almost halfway there. I was like, what? Tomorrow's the 12th. That's halfway to the 24th. So I'm like, wow, my Advent calendar is filling up. And this week we're headed to the darkest week of the year, as I mentioned earlier. And so we need joy right now. And we need to be people who share joy with others. Now, joy isn't necessarily just laughter and jokes like you might get. Like, what do angels say to each other? Does anybody know how? Okay, Seth, how do angels greet each other? What do they say to each other? Halo, halo, halo. Get it? He doesn't want it. All right, how about this one? How does a gingerbread man make his bed? What does he use? Cookie sheets. I know, it's bad. And here's one somebody brought from, we had our gala, which was wonderful, and some tables had crackers. Those are English poppers, and they had jokes inside of them. So this was a joke. Well, we love our Christmas lights. Well, what kind of lights did Noah have on the ark? Floodlights. Of course. What goes oh, oh, oh? Do you know that one? That's right. Santa walking backwards. Now you got some good jokes you can share with others. Because we're invited to bring joy. Our job is, if you need to bring something to a party, step up and bring the joy. It's a good challenge, and our devotionals have some good challenge about this. Take on a job that's unpleasant and bring some joy to it. And so I had, at first service, someone left and said, I'm going to go home and tell my husband we talked about toilet paper and Kleenex at church today. And we did. So I had an example about, like, if it said in the book, to get your family unit together or yourself or whoever, if you live by yourself, in our house, it'd be me and Paul. And so you have some household chores to do. And so you challenge each other to do the chores with joy. And so I said, if you have somebody who's grouchy about having to pick up the trash and empty the trash, then there's ways you can give joy about it. And the way you can do joy is by being thankful that the trash gets picked up. And I know you think this is crazy, but I am grateful every time I hear the trash truck coming down our street and they empty our trash. And the reason I'm grateful is because in ministry, I've been in a lot of places. throughout these years. I have not lived in a clean, beautiful city of Dwight all my life. I have been invited to go out in other places that are not good. And so, like on TV when they were showing about a tornado one place, and the guy from the Weather Channel was showing this tree that had been knocked down in the tornado, and then he showed the yard full of junk. And I thought to myself, now that guy does not know what he's doing. Because it was clear to me that that yard was that way before the tornado came through. Now, I have been in those kind of places. I have been in those kind of houses when there's trash everywhere. And so that made me very grateful that the trash gets picked up and taken away. I am very grateful for that, because if you've ever been in those places, you know you're not alone. There's lots of little animals and other bugs crawling around, and you only hope you don't take any with you. So when your family member is grouchy about picking up the trash, just Google some of those places. If you can't have a place to take them, Google them. And think about, to ask them what they think your house would be like if nobody took the trash out. And then I said, you can enjoy, when you take the trash out, I think about things I'm thankful for. And in our trash can, especially during the fall, it's been a lot of Kleenex. And I'm thankful for Kleenex. Because sometimes we've run out of Kleenex and I had to use toilet paper. Or worse, a paper towel. There's a reason we have Kleenex, and it's good. So there are reasons you can give thanks. Or I said, think about if you had to fold the clothes. And you know, you get tired of folding all these clothes, right? Well, why don't you try to wear the same clothes for a whole week? Yeah, find out how good that is. Find out how good your body feels. If you don't take a shower or don't have any clean stuff for a whole week or longer, yeah, then you really appreciate it. So those are things you can do to remind yourselves that gratitude helps us bring joy into a situation. We're grateful we can do these things. We're grateful we have these things. And we can trust that God is with us and that we are loved by God. And so when we're confident of God's love, that also helps us have joy. And those are gifts we need. And Mary and Elizabeth brought those gifts to each other, that they both had things. Elizabeth had this child, and she wasn't sure that he was supposed to be, his name was John, and she wasn't sure why she, as an older woman, would have a baby like that. And believe me, I am very sympathetic to her. I'm like, wow, that would be a big thing for older people to have. And so how joyful it was for her to see Mary and realize, my baby is the beginning of the Messiah story. And wow, that would be so part of an epic narrative of the whole transformation of the world that she was going to be a part of. And that would encourage you during the last months of your pregnancy and you're older and your body's completely distended. Yeah, that would be helpful for that. So it's a wonderful thing that they did to each other, believing in God's promises and encouraging one another. And so, who can you compliment this week? Who can you encourage in your group of people for what they bring you? That's part of our job of sharing joy. Who can you lift up by saying something positive to? And we realized in our house with two pastors that we needed to work on that ourselves. That we're not always good about saying, you know, you are good about this or you are good about that. And so we need to hear it. So we started doing that to each other more. You know, thank you for doing this. That was a really good way you spoke to so-and-so. You did a great job this way. You really bring this into our lives. And that's beneficial not only to them who hears it, but it's beneficial to you because it reminds you to appreciate the people that are around you and in your life. And also, how can you compliment someone that's kind of grouchy or kind of irritating to you? That's a good challenge too. Because if you can find assets that they bring to you, that'll help you and their relationship. And that will lift you both up. So the promises of God are ours to have. And as we encourage other people, we live into those promises and it increases our joy. So if you have someone that you can encourage this week, I want you to think who that could be. And if you need someone to encourage you, think about who could you reach out to. One of the best things I've ever done is mentor someone. And Paul and I have mentored people, especially since I've been a career pastor all my life, basically, that I had people that were second career pastors that were a lot older than me, that I was their mentor and in the process. And that was really good for me and them. So think about who you can touch in a positive way this week and how that can lift you up. And if you, you know, if you, people who don't get any encouragement at all, that makes them even more grouchy and negative. And when we're grouchy and negative, that spreads really quickly. It seems like it takes a lot more joy and positiveness than it does negative, right, in this world. So we have to really be working at that. And as you do, that really fills your heart up with good things. God is present with us, and we can give thanks to him. And so when we look at our frustrations and challenges, we know they can steal our joy. But we don't have to let them take it. We don't have to just hand it over to them. We can fight with it about it. You know, it doesn't have to be something that is, you know, super negative to cause us to be grouchy. You know, little things just going wrong can cause you to be grouchy. So challenge yourself to think, you know, what can I do not to let my joy be stolen? And remind yourself of these little Christmas jokes. That'll help you have some laughter. But, you know, remind yourself that God is with me in the good times and the challenging times. And sometimes the challenging times help me to become more like God, because I can be more trusting and I can be more open and I can be more listening when I'm really having stress, because I can't do anything else on my own. And so I have to turn to God to help me. And that helps me remind me of the process. So our invitation this week is to do good for other people, and especially maybe try to do it secret to bring more joy into our world. And to remind yourself that joy is not just laughter, but it's a substantial force. It's a force for good. And when we live joy-filled, we are more powerful. We are more influential, and our lives are better. And so enjoying God's gifts in all different ways is a way that we can be joy-filled, but also encouraging other people and finding joy in doing difficult things because they're part of our lives are ways that really help us grow as people and as Christians. So pursue joy, and that's not just finding all the stupid Christmas jokes you can. Pursue joy by finding all the good you can. And be thankful for it and grateful for it. And let your light shine out into this hurting world. And watch, especially this week of gloominess and darkness, how you will lift up where you're at. And that will really help you and others. And that will help us be the people God calls us to be. Our challenge as people of faith is to believe in God as much as God believes in us. And when we do, then that fills us with joy. Let us pray together. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, help us to serve other people by serving you in love and in joy. Help us to encourage each other, one another, bring into mind people that can mentor us and that we can mentor to share the journey of faith and to be encouraged with one another, like Elizabeth and Mary encouraged each other at this miraculous events of the birth of John the Baptist and of Jesus. But most of all, Lord, we just ask that you really fill us with love and hope and light so that we can really encourage each other and to be people who really are joy-filled, and that we can be strong, powerful, and influential for good in our world. We ask all of this in the name of our joy, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And all God's people say, amen. Friends, as we come to our time of community prayer, I have many that I want you to keep praying for. Del Hancock is home after he was in the hospital with a terrible case of the flu, but he is still recovering, so please keep him in your prayers. We're glad to see Dan Stefanski's back with us at church, but he has a bad toe, so please keep praying that heals up properly. Ed Bunting needs our prayers as he's been in the hospital on and off. Fran Hank needs our prayers. She's going to have open heart surgery on Tuesday. She's at Silver Cross Hospital. I talked to her a little bit ago. She sounds great, but her heart, it needs some help, so she's going to have that. Chuck Palmer has a brain bleed, and his family's going to have to make some hard decisions, so just keep praying for their family. Don't forget to pray for Harold Bissy, who's on hospice, and Richard Faust, who continues to have falls, and Anita Pollock, who's still not with us as she's recovering from COVID, and others who have, you know, we have so many respiratory things going on right now, so please, as we clear our throats and cough, please pray for them. And also, don't forget to pray for all our travelers who have a wonderful time of experience and opportunity to grow. And please pray for Dan Stefanski and his family for Genia. Is that right? Jeannie, sorry, thank you. Jeannie, who has stage 4 stomach cancer. Thank you. We'll be praying for Jeannie as well. And don't forget all the folks who are battling cancer. All right, let's go to God first silently and individually, and let's I'll conclude us with a pastoral prayer, and we'll all join together in the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray together. Loving and gracious Heavenly Father, some of the greatest joy in our lives comes from our beloved children, and we're just thankful that we were able to send out from this church so many gifts to our community's children. And we just pray each one of those touches someone's life with your love, and that they know they're loved and precious to you. And Lord, we thank you for all the food we are able to send out from here, and we just ask that those who are in need may know your provision and may know your presence in their lives as well. And remind us as we go through challenges to take on the invitation not to be so complaining, but instead to be affirming and to listen to the things we say and the looks we give, and that we can lift people up instead of stealing their joy. And that's what we do sometimes when we give them the stink eye look or say the mean thing or the judgmental comment, that is stealing people's joy, and it steals our joy. And Lord, we want to be joy-filled. We want to be that force for good in this hurting world. So right now, we just ask, oh Lord, as we praise you and magnify you, because you are great and your mercy knows no bounds. And things that are impossible for us are not for you. That's what Christmas shows us above all. That a virgin gave birth to the baby Jesus, the Son of God that transforms the world for good. And that because you have come, and when we have faith in you and through the power of your Holy Spirit, we can do amazing things in good ways for this world and for your kingdom. So we ask, O Lord, your special anointing and healing just rest on these we love. We pray for Fran Hank that her surgery go exceedingly well this week and she find the healing she needs. We pray for Del Hancock that he may be healed from this flu and others that are battling all these respiratory diseases that are around, that you may lift them up. We pray for Dan and his foot that you just heal his toe and help him to find the healing he needs. We pray for Ed to get the resolution that he needs and deliverance. We pray for Richard and Brad and others that continue to have falls, that you will knit them back together and give them strength as an encouragement. We pray for the Geshwins that aren't feeling that well today, that your special blessing will rest on them and on Anita. And we pray, O Lord, for Chuck and Harold, who are on a different journey and are on the journey to perfection, And we just pray for their families at this holy and transitional time that you'll provide all that they need and give them peace and strength. And we are especially mindful of those battling cancer, and we think of Jeannie and ask that you give her peace and encouragement and let these chemo treatments work effectively and just provide the healing she and so many need. We thank you, Lord, that you are able to take care of all these and so much more. We do ask that you bring peace to our world. We pray for those who don't know you, that we might be the witness to bring them into your kingdom and to have the words to say that offer them faith and hope and love and peace. Lord, thank you for the great opportunities you give us, and may we rise to the occasion this week to serve faithfully. And we pray all these things in Jesus' precious name. And we continue in our time of prayer, praying as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our closing praise. Joy to the world.
Oh,
join me right after church in the fellowship hall to set up tables and chairs. It shouldn't take us long if many of us go in there. And as we go forth, receive the benediction. Friends, today go forth in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Go forth being people who share joy, who are filled with joy, and who know the joy of the Lord as your strength. Go forth knowing that with God, all things are possible, and that God is indeed with you. So go forth, trusting and believing and being the light to the world. And all God's people say, amen.
I counted the tables. You only need to put up five more. Yes, I counted.
Lately, I've been real. Watching the nightly news.